attending this morning quickly and at your regular ceremonies for today's events. We have a wonderful afternoon of presenters lined up for you. Welcome to everybody outside watching our Jumbotron! Once again, we'd like to thank all of our sponsors. We'd like to thank the town of Seneca Falls and Jim Spina and his incredible staff here at the Community Center for providing this wonderful space for us today. And I would like to take a moment to ask our interpreters to please stand. Thank you once again to our American Sign Language interpreters who are with us here today all along. Thank you. Our first speaker is Tammy Mills. Tammy is a volunteer advocate for disability rights here in Seneca Falls. And currently serves on the board of directors of the Seneca County House of Concern. Her focus as a volunteer member of the board is on public relations for the organization, which provides an invaluable service to those in the community that are less fortunate. Tammy is here today to talk with us about working together as community for disability rights by being aware of different sets of needs for support in all arenas. I give you Tammy Mills.
Reimbursed wages. It was to be a temporary part-time position during income tax season. Being I think I have a hand as well as a fact that there was a step into the office, my mother would drive me to work, boost me to the door, and come back to pick me up. A permanent position was created, but there were complications. There were more steps in the new office. I told my father, and he said if she bought the materials, he would build a ramp. However, the bathroom did not meet my needs, which required it to be a part-time position. The ramp was filled, and I stayed at that job for 3 years, and eventually moved to another job with similar circumstances. And while some would think it was unfair, I was not one to make waves. I was just happy to be normal, getting up every morning, driving to work, being productive, and having enough income to make my hand payment. But due to my physical impairments, I've always been dependent on my parents as my caregivers, and for some financial support, therefore living at home. And when my mother started her own business next door to our house, it gave me the ability to stop working elsewhere and contribute to our family business, which was built with my niece in mind. So that's my story, and I consider myself very fortunate. People who do not have a support system and the socioeconomic status that I've had struggle daily to make ends meet and to support themselves and their families. But regardless of socioeconomic status, all people with disabilities encounter barriers every day, and yet we persist. Why? Because we have hope. Yes, we must overcome challenges, but ordinary things and accomplishments do not become extraordinary just because we do them. What is extraordinary are the challenges and barriers we must overcome to do those ordinary things. We know there should be no pity or tragedy in being a person with a disability. It is society's myths, fears, and stereotypes, and the barriers that society creates that causes the difficulties associated with disability. We also have hope because over the years we have witnessed very important positive change in many areas that improve our lives, including milestones such as the establishment of Medicaid and the passing of education for all handicapped children Act of 1975, which mandated public schools to provide equal access to children with disabilities. The law has improved and is now known as the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. And then in 1990, the American with Disabilities Act resulted in tremendous positive change in education, employment, transportation, and overall access. Other improvements have been witnessed in my life for people with all types of disabilities, with closed captioning and telecommunication relay services for the hearing impaired, increases in accessible transportation, athletics such as Special Olympics and Paralympics, audio descriptions and screen readers for the visually impaired, and the growing use of people first language, and so much more. But with all the positive change, there's still work to be done. People with disabilities have the highest rate of unemployment of any minority group. Accessible, affordable housing is hard to come by. And the fact that the United States in 2020 will finally have a system that assists the visually impaired to identify the different paper currencies, while many other supposedly less progressive countries were ahead of us in this endeavor, speaks to the lack of priorities in our nation. And there is cause for concern for our future in many areas. A few that stand out to me is the repeal of the Affordable Care Act, the veil of the obvious attempts to undermine public education, the new tax law, which will more than likely require cuts to services to people with disabilities, and the recent attack on the civil rights of people with disabilities with the proposed bill, H.R. 620, a bill introduced last year to amend the ADA. Access to affordable health care is something everyone should have and is critically important to those with disabilities. Many of the issues that people have may be reduced by making sure they have access to quality health care, including preventive health screening. And yet, with the repeal of the Affordable Care Act, tax cuts for the wealthy, and the call for a reduction in Medicaid threatens most of the most important programs that enables Americans with disabilities to live independently and to just live. And H.R. 620, titled the ADA Education Reform Act of 2017, which has 104 sponsors for the bill, with four just signing on last week. The main objective of this bill is to protect businesses who are not complying with the ADA by making people with disabilities go through several steps which allows procrastination and making the necessary changes without fear of litigation. Therefore, they may never comply. And the supporters of this legislation have absolutely no issue with shifting the burden to the people who are supposed to be protected. This goes completely against other civil rights laws that allow individuals to immediately seek relief to gain access. And being my time is limited, if you do not know about this proposed bill, I ask that you research. And remember that businesses must comply with many other complex and detailed laws and have had over 27 years to comply with the ADA. If this bill is passed, people with disabilities could be indefinitely denied access to the same goods and services as all other Americans, and a wait-and-see attitude could become the norm. So I shared with you my personal experiences with physical disability, but I just want to be sure that we do not forget about the people with hearing impairments, visual impairments, mental health conditions, intellectual, developmental, and cognitive impairments. And to those who do not have a disability, never forget that you are only an accident or sudden illness away from becoming disabled. Or over time, you may become impaired in some way due to a chronic disease or simply from aging. With our aging population outliving previous generations, those numbers are quickly increasing. Not only with issues such as dementia, but because people are living longer, they may need daily care. And in closing, people with disabilities are ordinary individuals who want to live ordinary lives. Women with disabilities are your mothers, daughters, sisters, friends, neighbors, and co-workers. People with disabilities are more like people without disabilities than we are different, and we make substantial contributions in a new society. So we ask that you help us continue to break down barriers and help us resist the powers that be who want to work against our rights. We ask that you stay vigilant and help us maintain our rights, which ultimately are your rights too. And let's continue to work together to ensure that all women's rights, which are human rights, are not diminished and work best for a better future for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tammy. Shauna O'Toole is founder of the nonprofit We Exist Coalition of the Finger Lakes, dedicated to outreach for the transgender, gender-expansive community in the greater Finger Lakes region. Shauna's background is in the physical sciences, previously serving as an industrial technician, engineer, and classroom teacher. Currently a Wegmans employee, she volunteers with the Rochester Area Out Alliance, coordinated programming for the age 35 and over transgender community. Please join me in welcoming Shauna O'Toole.
Thank you. Let me ask first, and feel free, if you don't feel safe, to not answer. How many brothers, sisters, and siblings do I have in the transgender, gender expansion community? Can I hear you? So good afternoon, my name is Sean Marie O'Toole, and I am the director of the We Exist Coalition of the Finger Lakes. We do outreach for the transgender, gender-expansive community here in the greater Finger Lakes area. Now, being the director of We Exist FLS is one of the things that I am known for, but it's not the only identity that I have. Here, let me give you some examples of identities that affect my life as a woman. First off, I'm a mom to an incredible 21-year-old young man. I'm a big sister to two siblings. I'm a daughter in which my parents were still alive to join with me and share in all the events that I've been having. I'm a scientist, I'm an engineer, I'm a classroom teacher, outreach educator, public speaker, author, I'm an advocate and an ally. My students used to ask, Ms. O'Toole, is there anything you haven't done? I look at them and say, I'm not sure. I'm also a pilot and I helped make the captain of the Civil Air Patrol, which is showing exhibit in the Air Force. Now, those are. Now, those are the easy ones. There are a few others that are a little bit more dicey. I'm also a lesbian. That means I am sexually attracted to some other women. And while many in the heteronormative world have their best gay friend, best lesbian friend, there are still places here in the United States where if I had a photograph of my girlfriend on my desk, I could get fired. Or if I walked out hand in hand with my girlfriend, it could invite violence of the worst kind. And as I'm sure you've already gathered, there's one other identity, one I'm very proud of. And that's the fact that I am transgender, you know, female. What this means is that I have always thought of myself as female, regardless of how my body developed. So yes, I was born this way. Now, acceptance for my people is growing. But with this administration, we have seen a rising level of hatred and fear. There are those who hate us, don't understand us, and because of that, were assaulted, raped, wounded, and killed. Two-thirds of my people will be either physically or sexually assaulted at least once in their lifetime. In 2017, statistically, there were almost 400,000 of us who were physically assaulted, 300,000 who were sexually assaulted. There is something to miss us because we just haven't accepted the fact that we're effeminate men. I'm sorry, I'm not a man. I've never seen myself as one. And there are those who preach hatred that we are pretenders. We are here to rape and assault other women, that we are robbing women of their private spaces, personal spaces, that we don't understand the struggle women, real women, have, or that we don't really understand what it's like to be under the thumb of male privilege. We don't understand. Who better than someone who is transgender, whether you be male to female, female to male, or even somewhere in between on the spectrum, to understand what male privilege is? When I transitioned, I surrendered every privilege I had, save race, to be offended. Race is one that you can't surrender. But if it cost that, I would have. Being authentic is more powerful, and that important. So what this means is that every degree, every accomplishment, every certificate, every award, every license, my passport, my birth certificate, mean nothing because I'm transgender. Now, I chose to be a citizen here. I was born on Earth, yes, with dual citizenship, but I have my U.S. citizenship papers. I'm proud to be a U.S. citizen until recently. We are not protected by any federal law. We're not protected by any New York State law. Oh yes, there are a couple executive orders here and there. But what can be written in can be written out, and we have seen that with this administration. And even though we are not protected by law, we are coming out by the thousands. We are standing proud, we are standing tall, Here in New York State, there are at least 200,000 of us. 200,000. Here in the greater Finger Lakes area, at least 15,000 of us. Across the United States, 3 million. 10% of us, 300,000 of us, are military vets, most of whom have done some of the most dangerous duty out there. I met Marine Recon, Navy SEAL, Green Beret, Blue Beret. I met Special Forces from other nations. Anything to try and prove ourselves manly man. Obviously a difficult. And 15,000 of us are presently serving in the armed forces. We are here. We are here, we have always been here. We are not going away. We exist. And we, like every other minority, are fighting for our right to live. Our fight is a fight for equality and justice, not just for my people, but for every woman and every minority, and indeed all people. And I want to emphasize this. Our fight is not just for white women. Our fight is for black women. Our fight is for brown women. We fight for Latinos, Asian women, Native American, First Nations women. We fight for Muslims, Indians, Jewish, Indian, and Asian women. We fight for those with different abilities and those who are mentally challenged. We fight for all Americans and all foreign residents, be you documented or undocumented. We fight. It's simple. The transgender community, my people, and I call us my people because we are so maligned by so many groups. We intersect every race, every culture, every socioeconomic group in the world. There's one last identity I'm going to share with you. Now, I have been called a warrior for my people. And presently, my people, like several other groups, are in the crosshairs of this president and this administration. Even more so now because it is becoming illegal for medical personnel to deny us treatment because of their religious beliefs. How many of us, be you, trans, gender expansion, LGBTQ, Muslim, Hindu, atheist, Native American, whatever, white, black, brown, Hispanic, Latina, will die because we go against someone's religious beliefs. This is unacceptable. More than ever, we need to join together. Quote Dr. Benjamin Franklin, we must surely hang together or we shall surely hang separately. We cannot afford this. One of the rules I found is Rule 89. Yes, it's actually written down, it's actually published. Rule 89 is simple. There are times you have to draw a line in the sand. There are times you have to be on that line. And there are times you are a line of one. And what I see right here are my sisters, brothers, and siblings standing on this line saying no to injustice, no to inequality. That we are all going to fight together to make America what it has always wanted to be, but never has been. A land of life, liberty, and the ability to pursue happiness with justice and equality for all people.
Michelle Casey proudly joins us today as President and CEO of Planned Parenthood of Central and Western New York. Overseeing a robust health system which serves more than 30,000 patients annually, multiple education and youth programs, and a sexual assault services program. She has over 30 years' experience in health and human services and is a proud champion of human rights. She is speaking today on women's reproductive rights.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you. Thank you for showing up. You've made a decision to be here today and stand in this community and to feel like what it's like to be a part of being active in change. 2017 was a remarkable year. As Planned Parenthood celebrated a milestone anniversary of 100 years, it is an unprecedented time where women are demanding nothing less than full equality and control over their bodies. Congress, at work, at school, at home, and in society. We saw and continue to see a pivotal moment of powerful men being held accountable for their actions, in addition to a heightened public awareness about the fundamental rights of women and men being able to control their future. Some politicians still keep trying to impose their beliefs on voters to attack healthcare and bodily autonomy. Each time the attacks on individual freedoms and healthcare intensify, the resistance and call for opposition rises to meet them, and thank you for that. Many politicians are not turning into the Me Too movement and the larger conversation in this country's been having over how to treat women equally. Anti-women's health majorities in the House and Senate in the Trump-Pence administration are signaling they will continue their assault on women's health and rights in 2018. Looking forward, we have a lot of work to continue doing. Here are some key things to look at in 2018 on the federal level. The attacks on Planned Parenthood health centers will mostly shift from Congress. There were 6 votes in 2017 that we effectively defeated. So again, thank you. With the election of Doug Jones, a Democrat in Alabama, you hear that right? Republicans no longer have the votes necessary to defund Planned Parenthood in Congress, which would prohibit Medicaid patients from coming to Planned Parenthood centers for care, which is crazy, right?
Yeah, crazy.
My God. Unfortunately, the Trump-Pence administration still has a number of mechanisms at its disposal to undermine millions of women's access to health care at Planned Parenthood health centers. Most notably, attacks on the Title X program, which helps women who don't have the money to pay for care to get care. The HHS political leadership is widely expected to take administrative action in the near future to interfere with access to basic health care under Title X, such as birth control, STI and HIV services, and cancer screenings, because it's so controversial. Essential safety net programs like Medicaid, Medicare, and Social Security are on the menu in 2018. At the end of 2017, Congress passed tax legislation that will radically increase the deficit, providing anticipated justification for making significant cuts to the social safety net programs. Medicaid provides insurance coverage to 1 in 5 women of reproductive age, and more than 16 million women aged 19 to 64. An attack on the program would undermine equitable access for health care. The result would create a public health crisis. In New York alone, 53% of the births that happen in this state are funded under the Medicaid program. Opponents of abortion will advance abortion bans despite the small chance of passing any into law. Monday is the anniversary of Roe v. Wade. The right to safe legal abortion does not matter if there is not access to services. Since 2010, we have seen nearly 400 restrictions on abortion across this country. 90% of counties lack an abortion-providing clinic. This is not acceptable. At the state level, we must act in New York. We have the opportunity to pass critical legislation. Here's what we are focusing on. There's the Comprehensive Contraception Coverage Act. Say that three times fast. CCCA. The act, the average woman spends about 30 years of their life trying to prevent pregnancy. I know, it's crazy, right? Try to take a pill every day, apparently, for that period of time. The use of contraception reduces unintended pregnancy and abortion. Contraception allows women to gain economic independence and to lead meaningful lives. Please call your elected officials and tell them to bring the CCCA to the floor for a vote, including emergency contraception. That has to be codified into New York State law. Right now there's an executive order, and we've seen what happens with executive orders when there is regime change. This year, again, we call for a Roe v. Wade to be codified into state law. We want it in the New York State Constitution so that every woman will continue to have access to the law. Women need and should be trusted to have personal autonomy over their bodies and their lives. Women, make it known that you want Roe v. Wade codified into New York State law. We must work together to pass other meaningful legislation in New York that protects human rights, like the Comprehensive Sexuality Education Legislation, the DREAM Act, which allows undocumented immigrants in New York to apply for state college tuition. Discrimination based on gender identity or expression. And protection for pregnant inmates. That's just a portion of our focus. There's more. I know you want to be the change makers. Here's what we're asking you to do. Understand the issues. Work to destigmatize abortion. Understand why and who gets abortions. Shed your judgment. Planned Parenthood has a lot of resources on this, and we can help with the conversation. Lift up the importance of contraception. Push it into daily conversation. It really impacts all of us. Let's talk about it. Talk to people, especially people who don't agree with you, even if it hurts. Listen to women. Believe women. Let people speak their truth. Especially listen to women of color. Every barrier that we talk about is a bigger barrier for women of color. We need to look at systemic racism and what we're doing to be a part of that and how we can break down those barriers. Be inclusive. No matter gender, race, sexual orientation, immigration status, identity, we are a community, and when one of us is not free, none of us is free. Participate in voter action. Canvas, speak out, rally, go door to door, go to churches, speak at your PTA, vote, maybe even run for office. Really matters. It's already changed 2017. Keep pounding the pavement. As the CEO of Planned Parenthood, please let me say that we are in solidarity with every person, organization, and her sister that is smashing through the glass ceiling. We must continue on this path to make true and lasting change. When women thrive, we all thrive. Free birth control, evidence-based sex ed, maternal health, teaching consent, paid family leave, paying a living wage. We know these are essential to a thriving and happy economy, society, and world. Every day I have the pleasure of leading an organization that takes care of 1 in 5 women in this country. I know looking out at this crowd, there are countless patients and supporters amongst us. It is with a deep sense of gratitude that I say thank you for standing with Planned Parenthood. Your power is endless. Let's keep this pivotal work up so the next 100 years we can write a new story for women.
Juanita Perez-Williams is a lifelong public advocate committed to service. She is the granddaughter of Mexican migrant farm workers who gave her the passion to fight injustice against the poor and vulnerable. Overcoming her own personal hardships, Juanita graduated from law school, dedicating her career to government service. She previously served as a naval lieutenant commander, Assistant New York State Attorney General, adjunct professor at Syracuse University, and Syracuse City Corporation Council. Most recently, Juanita ran for mayor of the city of Syracuse, where she won her primary race, but lost in the general election. Juanita is on a mission to help end systemic racism and sexism, combat poverty, rejuvenate neighborhoods, and protect our youth. She currently is an attorney in the city of Syracuse. I give you Juanita Perez.
Good afternoon, my persisters. Here today, and so proud to be making history with you today. I don't have to tell any of you in the room, my sisters, that racism and sexism, misogyny are alive in this country and around this world, and we need to continue fighting this fight as we come together today. I, like you, decided after what I saw last November that I had to get into this battle. And so while it was not easy, I decided to jump into the political battlefield. Although I did not win my race, I will go down in history, herstory, as the first Latina to win a mayoral primary in the top 5 cities in New York State. But this revolution continues. I will not give up, and I will ensure those that were with me and followed this race, and all that happened through this race continues, and we continue to inspire the women, the many of women of color, who woke up to see their own power and what we could do. The reality is that racism and sexism are throughout this country, in the boardroom, at the gym, in politics. I felt it, I heard it, and it was amazing that it was happening in 2018. But I want to make sure that my voice today is for all those women, women of color too, especially, who would never have an opportunity to be in a room such as this, to be with us. Because they're mopping floors, they're picking grapes, and they're in places none of us could fathom. And they'll never have a voice. And their dreams will only remain dreams. And that's why we do this, for those women, and we must continue this fight. It's not like there isn't enough material in the news today on the issues of sexism and racism, thanks to our very stable genius of a president. And while these words are shocking and hurtful, I will tell you that many women of color are not surprised that we have a leader like this today. We see these leaders. We hear them. They are men. They are women. They are our bosses. They are around us. So we know what that feels like. We know what it's all about. The other day, I saw a tweet asking facetiously, when did you know that 45 was a racist? Was it when he called all Mexicans rapists? When he banned all Muslims? When he pardoned Joe Arpaio? I knew it. The same can be asked, when did you know that this fearless leader was a sexist? On the bus with Billy Bush? When he called women fat pigs and dogs? Or when he said that women should be punished for having abortions? I knew it. We have to come to grips with the fact that this president is not only a sexist and a racist, but that his hate-filled rhetoric is meant to divide us. Man against woman, woman against women, white women against women of color. That's what it is meant to do, and we must not forget that. A survey of 2016 voters concluded that people who voted for this fearless leader, 45, was not because of individual or community or national economic distress. It's because people were scared when they heard about immigration, when they heard about a diverse, growing society, when they heard about inclusivity, and they voted out of fear. I knew it, and so did many of you. These are just the many reasons that we must stand together. Because I will tell you, in a race in 2017 for mayor, it was all around me. Many of the sentiments that we saw at the national level were at the local level. And although I recognized it, there were others that did not. Voters were told, with the knocks on their door, that because I am Hispanic, I was going to allow unlimited numbers of undocumented people into our city. The fear was there. That as a woman, I lacked the temperament to hold public office, notwithstanding my 6 years serving honorably as a naval officer. And that's because children and a beautiful grandson, somehow this implied a sort of deficit or flaw in my character. These were just some of the insidious tactics used against me, and are used all the time against women, especially women of color. And make no mistake, they are intended to undermine and disparage candidates. So how do we stop this? How do we dispel these fears, this hate that is all around? Well, I was very delighted to hear Oprah Winfrey talk about this recently. You heard. She said it starts with speaking your truth. Your truth about how you have felt marginalized by people in power, whether at work, in the community, wherever you are, that we must speak our truth, no matter how difficult it is. And the Me Too movement is the greatest example today of people starting to speak their truths, showing others we're not alone, we're in this together. But I will tell you, in my own race, I knew that this truth needed to come out. And so I spoke this truth. I went out there and I talked about who I am, where I came from, and wanted voters to know my story, never realizing that in 2017, there would be tactics used against me, distracting me, detracting from my own qualifications and my own efforts, and just a focus on the color of my skin and the voice that I have. So I tell all of you, don't give up. I didn't give up. On the last debate that we had, just a few days before the general election, I found hope. I found hope with my Republican female opponent, who could have ignored what was happening to me. But to her credit, and perhaps a reason why she too lost that race, she stood up on live TV and pointed out to our male opponent what was happening and the remarks that were being said, and that they were being said to undermine a woman candidate. And to her, I applaud standing up. So yes, we need to tell our stories. But more than that, if we can't tell our story, or perhaps we don't feel as though we have one, know that there are people out there. Get behind them. Recognize that story. Be with them. Don't let them do it alone. Stand with them and let them know how proud we all are. Look it, we're not always going to agree. We're not going to be on the same political side. But human dignity must come before anything else. And as women, we must be the example. Whether it's in the workplace, home, in the community groups you're in, or in politics. And that doesn't mean, again, that you have to agree, but just stand up. Stand up for women. We stand at the birthplace of the women's rights movement. And we celebrate the women before us that have the courage to fight for basic human rights. We are the beneficiaries of those efforts. But the question now for us is, how will history judge us? Will we stand still and watch how other women fall? Or will we stand with them, help them get up, and together move forward? I say we can do it. I say we do it together. We get in that battle and we win.
Thank you, Juanita.
1 o'clock, there is a moment of silence that people around the world are taking to just acknowledge one another as we all stand here in solidarity to stand for our freedoms and our equal rights. It's 1:58. I would prefer to do it now so we don't interrupt our next speaker. So can we all just take a moment of silence in honor of what we're doing here to stand up for our freedoms and equal rights for all. Thank you. Nadia Sharam is a practicing attorney and mediator in Western New York and is the president and founder of the Coalition for the Advancement of Muslim Women. Ms. Sharam serves on the board of the Family Justice Center of Erie County and is an advocate for immigrants and refugees residing in Buffalo. She is speaking with us today on immigrant rights in America.
Marching and standing together with my sisters and some brothers. In unity for justice. We are also here in celebration of our collective strength and voice. We are currently living extremely surreal and tumultuous times for our nation. And I can't help but to also feel solidarity with my sisters in Iran who are fighting battles for basic human rights. My short talk today focuses on immigration in this country. But it is also a comment and a reminder on the basic fabric of our great, incredible nation of the United States. Make America great again, he said. The America that I experienced and lived as an immigrant is and will continue to be great. I immigrated from one of the 6 nations that currently is banned from entering this country, Iran. Our great America is built on immigrant and immigration. These are the people who built this great nation. The America that I know is inclusive, compassionate, generous, and welcoming. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe. That is the America that I have grown to love and respect. My America welcomed me as a teenager with open arms. The woman that I have become today is the result of that generosity, the opportunities and experiences, many of which are not available to my sisters in Iran and other places. If we are going to call ourselves the greatest nation in the world, then we should be up to that. And that includes a moral standard and human dignity. Our immigration policy needs to reflect such beliefs. In my own experience, I was able to attend a university and go to law school. I was able to start a business as well as a law firm. I was given the freedom of expression and was able to write a book. I have had the opportunity to freely travel around the world. These are all experiences that I may not have had if I was denied access to this country. I now work in my community in Buffalo, helping refugee families and more. And my story is not unique. America is filled with success stories from millions of immigrants who are productive and contributing members of their community. The idea that the president is repealing DACA is maddening. The idea of building a wall is absurd. That is not the America. We have gone off the path of greatness. Let us get back to being a nation of equality of justice. And we can only do these actions through what we are doing here today.
Executive Director of the Erie County Commission on the Status of Women, which works to provide meaningful information and resources to the women and girls of Erie County and to ensure they participate fully in matters that have an impact on their lives. Dr. King has served as an adjunct graduate faculty member in the Higher Education Student Affairs Administration program at Buffalo State College and in the Graduate School of Education at the University of Buffalo. Dr. King's research interests include examining how gender, race, class, and popular culture impact women's and girls' identity development. She is here today to share insight on a woman's right to economic justice in America.
Fellow speakers who are continuing to speak truth to power. And there's one thing we know for sure. Patriarchy, misogyny, you got to go. You like numbers? You like numbers? Here's some numbers to think about. 55. The number of years since JFK signed the Equal Pay Act in 1963. 89. While New York has the smallest pay gap of any state in the nation, white women earn 89 cents on the dollar. 85. 66. 50. Women of color earn less. New York's Asian Americans, African Americans, and Hispanic and Latino women are paid 85 cents, 66 cents, and 50 cents, respectively, for every dollar earned by white non-Hispanic males.
Well, I would have wanted to do it too, you know.
77.
I don't know these people.
Women in New York earn less per dollar than men, while 77% of single-parent families in New York
are headed by women, and these single mother families represent the largest number of families living in poverty in every region of New York State. 50. More than 50% of minimum wage workers in New York are women. It's been more than 50 years since President Kennedy signed the Equal Pay Act, yet women continue to make less than their male counterparts, a persistent phenomenon that cannot be entirely explained by disparities in education, opportunity, or childbearing. The gender pay gap may differ by year, location, and ethnicity, but it is persistent. The gender pay gap has hovered between 80 and 50% for nearly two decades. Most of the discrepancy is because men work in high-paying fields, in more lucrative fields, and most of the policy remedies have focused on encouraging women to pursue those same high-paying fields with a particular focus on STEM jobs. Women make up half of the U.S. total population, women make up half the total U.S. college-educated workforce, but only 29% of the science and engineering workforce. We are told to lean in, we are told to negotiate, don't leave money on the table. While I agree those are important skills, but there is much more to this story. In 2017, the Me Too movement has given voice to the long-standing prevalence of sexual harassment in the workplace. As a result, the mainstream press has also given some recent attention to a body of research that points to an under-examined cause of the pay gap. Women make less because of the sexual harassment they face at work. Some recent academic research focuses on the relationship between sexual harassment and the gender wage gap. In a 2017 study entitled The Economic and Career Effects of Sexual Harassment on Working Women, researchers found sexual harassment increases financial stress, largely by precipitating job change, and can significantly alter women's career attainment. Specifically, the study found that women who reported having been sexually harassed at work were 6.5 times more likely to change jobs compared to women who had not been harassed. And often the change was not to a higher salary or a more prestigious profession. The negative effects that can accompany such a job change were often found to follow women throughout the rest of their career. Hostile, toxic workplace environments for women have contributed to the persistent wage gap in several ways, including financial stress, occupational gender segregation, losing human capital, the ability to get a reference from an employer, a manager, or a colleague, and lack of seniority at your new job, which limits earning growth and increases vulnerability of layoffs and career instability. Understanding exactly how harassment affects earning power isn't easy because abuse is notoriously underreported, especially at the professional and managerial levels. And at the same time, jobs and fields that are dominated by women and considered safer because there are less men in them also usually pay less. According to the Institute for Women's Policy Research, occupational gender segregation continues to be a strong feature of the U.S. labor market. Among the 502 occupations identified by the Census Bureau, the report suggests that progress towards occupational segregation was made in the 1970s and 1980s, but that virtually no more progress can be observed since the mid-1990s. According to the report, there are two reasons why stark occupational segregation should be a concern to policymakers. Socialization in relation to gender norms continues to influence men and women's average preferences and behaviors. Much of these patterns reflect barriers to entry to occupations ranging from lack of information about alternative job options to active discouragement and harassment. A second reason for concern is the link between occupational segregation and gender inequality in earnings. Full-time employed women, on average, earn less than their male counterparts in 104 of the 108 occupations for which the Bureau of Labor Statistics provides earning data for both male and female workers.
This suggests that the gender wage gap is almost a universal feature of the labor market, regardless of where women work, regardless. At the same time, female-dominated occupations have been shown to pay less than male-dominated occupations at the same skill level. This implies that even if there is a gender wage gap within all occupations, women must be able to increase their absolute earnings by choosing to train for work in occupations with higher shares of male workers. Well, guess what happens? Conversely, while higher shares of male workers may mean higher wages for women, it will also increase the opportunity for greater incidents of sexual harassment. So the proverbial catch-22, what do we do here? Legislation, policy, those are all important components that we have to continue fighting for. But we must eradicate misogyny from our work cultures. And this is a long game, folks. So don't be fooled, and I don't mean to disparage any of the programs that encourage us to lean in or negotiate or leave or don't leave money on the table. Those are very popular programs. But many of the women out there in the workforce do not have the luxury of negotiation. They're minimum wage workers. They're undocumented workers. They are not making enough money, and they do not have the clout to speak for themselves. The workplace continues to be a hostile environment that has to end. So it's such an honor to be with all of you today. Continue that fight. Demand that harassment and toxicity be eradicated from our workplaces.
Thank you, Karen. Yvonne Taylor, our next speaker, has environmental justice in her blood. In 2011, when Texas-based Crestwood wanted to turn the west side of Seneca Lake into the largest fracked gas storage and transport hub in the U.S., Yvonne Taylor helped found and became vice president of Gas Free America. Along with thousands of residents within her community, has been successful in keeping this multi-billion dollar corporation out of the Finger Lakes for the past 7 years. Garnering support from 32 municipalities in the state and representing 1.2 million New York voters. Harnessing this momentum to help found Seneca Lake Guardian, a waterkeeper affiliate, a group designed to continue to protect and preserve the Finger Lakes for generations to come. Yvonne Taylor.
Thank you. I am both honored and humbled to be here in the birthplace of the women's rights movement with so many amazing people. I live along Seneca Lake on land that has been in my family for generations. I've always had a love of the Finger Lakes, and my mother fostered that love, telling me that Seneca Lake had healing powers. We live in a bucolic tourist destination that has become world class. When I learned that a Texas company wanted to turn our home into a major gas storage and transport hub, I looked around for someone to do something about it. The more I researched the project, the more alarmed I grew. Storing fracked gas in unlined salt caverns bisected by a fault line along a drinking water resource for 100,000 people? Surely someone would take charge and stop this ill-conceived project. But nobody came forward. I soon realized that someone would have to be me. I didn't consider myself an activist, and I had no experience in fighting something like this. But But in looking back, I don't think I chose this fight. I think it chose me. This has been a battle that most have said was unwinnable. We've been called names, they've tried to discredit us, and they've tried to intimidate us, but we persisted. What started out as a few people grew into a collective force of thousands. Over the past 7 years, we formed a coalition of 500 regional businesses, held forums, created alliances with other groups, obtained pro bono legal services from a renowned environmental law firm, Earth Justice, connected Seneca Lake communities with one another to create a united front, made countless trips to Albany and Washington to meet with decision makers, and mounted tremendous pressure on Governor Cuomo to side with the families and businesses of the Finger Lakes, not a Texas gas company. Corporation that's greedy endeavor to destroy our community into positive community action. They are retreating and we are prevailing against Goliath. We recently learned that a new corporation wants to build the largest trash burning plant in New York, only 3,200 feet from a K-12 school. Located squarely between Seneca and Cayuga Lakes. These lakes contain trillions of gallons of fresh water on which hundreds of thousands rely for drinking water. In a region that is rich with agriculture, farming, and wineries. And so, we are called upon to fight again. To fight for our most basic human right to clean air and water. We can all do this. Every one of us, and we must. Our battles here are no different from ones you face at home, because wherever home is for you, the air, water, and soil comprise the very cells of your being. You literally become whatever your surroundings contain, whether they be pure or contaminated. The creation of our future begins with looking at our own cities, towns, and suburbs. This is where we can make the biggest difference. With the current administration abandoning many of the laws that should protect us, and corporations motivated by greed with no concern for the health and safety of the neighborhoods they invade, it is up to us to keep our communities safe from toxic assaults. We are so much more than any corporate boardroom.
Oh, yeah!
Is real and it does not discriminate. It impacts us whether we're rich or poor, no matter where we live, no matter what color or gender we are. We are at a critical time where we must act now, for there's no room to go backwards. There can only be a determination to do what must be done. We must challenge outdated and destructive power plants, reckless development and decrepit infrastructure that threatens our health and the health of our planet. We, the people, must send a clear message, loud and clear, that we will not back down to attacks on our core rights. We will organize, we will march, and we will act to protect what is most vital. Water. Nothing else matters if we don't have a planet that sustains life. We the people must choose to win, for if we don't win, we perish. And yet the enormity of it may seem too daunting, a bit too depressing as we go about our daily lives. What can one person possibly do? I'm here to tell you that you can do a lot. Each one of you has faced what felt like an insurmountable challenge. You've struggled, you've wondered if you'd make it to the other side, and you've persisted. You've grown stronger, more powerful as a result. Now take that power and join it together with those beside you today. Can you feel how strong we are together? We must plug into this energy and carry it with us as we go back into our own communities. Tomorrow, next week, next month, tap into this strength. Organize, mobilize, be ready to participate in change. Be ready to be the change. Participation alone is what compels government to truly serve the public interest. We need a government that is actively for the people, and we're only going to get it if we're organized and demand it. The current president has galvanized us and forced us to come out of our comfort zones. Millions of us have united to take action and to speak our minds, even if our voices tremble. We are speaking out loudly and bravely against the things that threaten our equality, our dignity, our very planet. We should never have to choose between a clean environment and a prosperous economy. We don't have to choose between clean air, clean water, and the energy needed to power our homes. We can create our future. And when we get struck down, we keep fighting. Never doubt for a moment the power that you have as an individual to bring about this change. We need to carry on the voices of our mothers and our grandmothers in speaking out together, and together we'll show the world what we're made of. Thank you.
Joyce Yearwood Drury, a member of the New York State Bar, is director of New York State Division of Human Rights, a graduate of New York Law School, where she was a member of the moot court and sat on the executive board. Her interest in employment and housing began in the law firm of Alterman and Booth, where she was exposed to her first sexual harassment employment discrimination complaint. Ms. Yearwood Drury joined the division in 1994 as a human rights specialist and promoted to director of the Sexual Harassment Unit in 1996. On behalf of the commissioner, she sat on the governor's task force to draft the Sexual Harassment Training Program for state employees. And traveled across the state representing the agency in its anti-discrimination mission.
How are you? And thank you. It is really an honor to be here today, as the other presenters have said, in such a historic place to talk about, obviously, an issue that is very important to me and has been my focus for probably most of my adult life. When I was invited here today, I said yes immediately. And in sitting with my former co-worker, Susan Sheridan, who is on the committee and is here somewhere running around, we talked about how did we get here. When we started on this mission of sexual harassment and eradicating sexual harassment in the workplace and in housing, we thought by now, when we were brave, that things would be a lot better. And although they are somewhat better, obviously we know it is nowhere near where it should be. And in many ways, it has gotten somewhat worse. So I'm here today hopefully to impart some information that will help women as we move forward to really look at eradicating sexual harassment from the workplace and really understanding how important it is that we do that. As I was preparing to come here this morning, I was watching TV, and I watched a testimony of gymnast after gymnast after gymnast talking about how they were abused by someone who they thought was supposed to help them and protect them. And the consistent thing throughout all these stories we hear, whether it's the Me Too movement or whether it is what we saw on TV this morning, it is that we need to speak out contemporaneously. Yeah. Every gymnast this morning said, I told someone, and they said, keep quiet. He's going to get in trouble. The program's in trouble.
He should get in trouble.
Exactly. Exactly. My answer is, so what? That person is doing something wrong, and you are not. And what women have to remember is that we do have to stand together. And if we don't speak out, if I did not speak out, if Susan did not speak out and make this an important part of her life, many other women would have been sexually harassed. So because those early gymnasts listened, many other women were sexually harassed and abused. It is important that we speak out, we take the chance. It is tough. I'm not saying it's easy. I've spoken out. Like our former presenter said, it's usually at a loss. You might have to leave that job. It is an economic harm. But until we speak out and speak strongly and say we're not going to let it happen, it is going to continue. There are laws here to protect us. There are laws in place. Trust me, I worked on those laws very early in my law school career. We pushed the state to have legislation in the area of sexual harassment. But unless we use those laws, they're useless. We look at the civil rights movement. The laws were in place. They had to be used. That's what Martin Luther King did. He used the laws that were there to benefit his cause. We have to use those laws. I heard Shauna speak earlier. She said there are no laws to protect people of transgender. They are. The human rights law protects gender. It doesn't matter whether you are a woman, transgender, or a man. We protect you. You have to file the complaint. And I will say, the process is not perfect. I know that. It is a very tough process to file a complaint and to come forward with allegations of sexual harassment or any form of discrimination, whether it be race, sexual harassment, disability. It is usually going to be at a loss of the person who's complaining, even if you win the case. I remember my first boss in an employment discrimination law firm sat with me in a room after he won a multi-million-dollar settlement, and he was kind of down and sad. I was so excited. It was my first big case. We won. I thought it was the greatest day in the world. And he said, you know what, Joyce? I'm happy today, but my victims are never made whole. They're never made whole. The experience is going to change their lives forever. But that experience can change their lives in a positive way. You're opening the path to end discrimination for all those women who are coming behind you. If that employee is disciplined, if that employee is terminated, if that doctor is removed, he would not have been violating all the women after. So my message today is, please complain. Lodge the complaints. When people tell you, don't go forward with a complaint. Go forward with a complaint. If they're not listening to you in the human resources department, find a private law firm. Go to the bar association. Go to women's groups. Find someone to move your complaint forward. Don't let that person telling you, be quiet. Don't let that person win. Go forward and find somewhere to put your complaint. There are public agencies again, there are private law firms. There,
we've heard. We were pissed off without charge.
Thank you. I want to talk a little bit about why, even in New York, we have a law that is so expansive that people really don't fully understand that everyone's protected. Shauna is protected. I'm protected. You're protected. As a matter of fact, under the federal law, you need 15 employees to file. In New York State, if it's sexual harassment, because we realize quite often people are targeting small businesses where they know they can get away with it. You don't need a number of employees. If you come in and you say I work in a business and my boss is doing something inappropriately, that's all we need to know. We're going to take that complaint and we're going to go forward.
Yeah!
The governor has also, with obviously our agency pushing changes in this law, has said that complainants now can get attorney's fees in gender cases. So you have many attorneys now who are much more open to taking cases because they're not going to lose money, and I'm not distracting attorneys. It is difficult to litigate these cases. So obviously, they need to get paid. But now we said if you have a successful case, you're going to get your attorney's fees. So remember, the laws are expansive. There are protections against retaliation. So when these individuals are saying to you, oh, they're going to fire you when you complain, let them fire you. Because then you get even more damages for the retaliation. And I really genuinely mean this. The law and the judges do not like retaliation. They do not. They're very hard on it. So all those stories I heard this morning about I'm going to be punished, no. Judges say we put a law in place to allow people to complain. When they see that an employer has actually retaliated against a victim, and I see it all the time. I went around the state talking about retaliation 5-10 years ago because it's the biggest thing. You complain and they write you up. Every time you come and write, you're written up. Every time you do anything wrong, then you're written up, and then you're fired about a year later. Well, you know what? We know that trick. We've seen it. We send those cases to hearing, and the governor has now said our commissioner can issue fines to those type of employees. Yeah. So if you're an employer who really has a negative animus and you retaliate, you're probably going to be not only paid damages to your victim, but you can be fined. And our commissioner has issued fines in excess of $5,000-$10,000 to employers who have taken retaliatory actions against victims. So again, although these laws are not perfect, they're there, and they have to be used. As we see today with the Me Too movement, what happened when people spoke up? People got fired at the highest echelons of their organizations. They're fired, they're removed, they're not coming back. And that is what these complaints can do. Even if they're not perfect, I tell most victims, sexual harassment ends when they file their formal complaint. Employers, housing providers, are not going to allow you to be victims of sexual harassment while there's an active state claim going on. So again, may not be perfect, but if you're a victim, filing the complaint can 99.9% of the times end that victimization. And then we can deal with how are we going to handle that person and the legal part. But don't worry about the legal part. The most important thing is file the complaint to end the abuse that you might be suffering in your workplace. I've left many brochures outside, again, not only my organization, but many other organizations and attorneys across the state who are there to help victims of discrimination and sexual abuse. In addition, remember, these things are intertwined, as some of our speakers have said earlier. When you leave a job for sexual harassment, it affects your salary. That's why you end up taking a job that might be a little bit less. I have many victims who are fired in their probationary time because you can't perform, you're being sexually harassed. And then employers say, well, they want to perform, of course they want to perform. You're being sexually harassed. You're not at your best if you're being victimized. We also cover pregnancy and the interrelationship between pregnancy and disability. We also handle issues of gender disability and disability claims and how it affects women differently in the workplace with sexual harassment. So just remember, domestic violence, we cover domestic violence. If you're a woman and you're a victim of domestic violence and you need to go to a court appearance, you have the right to take time off and not be terminated. So remember, there are laws out there to protect women, not only in sexual harassment, but in many other areas. We just have to try to use them, try to make them better when we see they don't work well, but please do use them. And the way to end and eradicate sexual harassment is exactly what we're doing right now, is to speak up, be strong. One other thing I want to end with is, another thing that we saw in this recent movement is one of the most important things we can do is when we're the person next to it and we see it going on, we have to say something. I want to speak to a lot. I said, you know, I watched a lot of Brad Pitt movies after that whole thing. I said, Brad went and spoke up, all right. But he should have gone and spoken up too. You know, Brad should have not really confronted him. Brad should have gone and spoken to whoever in the film industry that he needed to speak to. The point is that when often the woman's not there when the woman's being sexually harassed, who's there? It's usually another man. And when those males speak up and say, no, what you just did to Joyce was not nice. You need to stop, and I'm gonna go and tell the supervisor. That, together, when we work together, because sexual harassment to a woman harms our males also, we have to remember that. It's a myth that men are not harmed, it is. You know, it's your sister, it's your daughter, it's your wife, it's your mother. So just remember that. I was telling my co-presenter that recently my brother's gotten a lot of kudos, because I remember when I was very young, before I even went to law school, he spoke up about a woman who was sexually harassed in his workplace and eventually had to leave the job because of the retaliation that he suffered. And I remind him all the time that you got a better job and you're a better person.
Thank you, Joyce. Our closing speaker, Reverend Leah Indwala, has been serving as pastor of First Presbyterian Church of Seneca Falls for 7 years. This historic church here on Cayuga Street is where, in 1923, women's activist Alice Paul delivered her impassioned speech, which has become known as the impetus and text of today's proposed Equal Rights Amendment. Reverend Indwala is here to speak with us about passage of the proposed ERA, which to this day is not included in the U.S. Constitution. Almost 100 years after Ms. Paul's memorable speech calling for a federal guarantee of equal rights for women, Leah is a returned Peace Corps volunteer who served in Kenya, and she is a wife and mother. Leah.
Thank you. People may have asked you today, why do you march? Women have access to education. Women have freedom to do so many things. We work. You're so far ahead in this nation. But nope, not according to the U.S. Constitution. Women have no equality under the U.S. Constitution, our greatest law in this land. So we march today because we persist. We persist in the knowledge that men and women were created and are and will forever remain equal. By the name of Alice Paul, during a celebration, a convention date, at the celebrating the Declaration of Sentiments in 1848. She spoke from the pulpit of the church where I serve as the pastor. And she read in these words, "Equality of rights under the law shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on the account of sex." Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg said, "If I were to choose an amendment to add to the Constitution, it would be the Equal Rights Amendment." She said, "I think we have achieved through legislation, but legislation can be repealed. It can be altered. We have seen that take place this year." So I would like my granddaughters, when they pick up the Constitution, to see the notion that women and men are persons of equal stature. I'd like them to see that as a basic principle in our society. Yeah. So we march. We march 94 years later to demand that it be ratified. We march 94 years later to show that we will march for however long it takes till women and men have rights that are affirmed by the U.S. Constitutionally equals equal and equality. We march 94 years later to declare that we shall be paid equal. We march 94 years later and declare that we do have sovereignty over our bodies. We march 94 years later to ensure that women do no longer have to endure and suffer under violence, violence by their government or violence in their own homes. We march 94 years later to demand that we have access to all fields, careers, and offices, like the one I hold. As a reverend, my title, and yet still across this land, there are people who think women like me should be denied access to speak. Well, we Christians, as that's one of my titles, we're going to reclaim that title. We're going to reclaim that title for people who are taking it away and twisted the scriptures that we love, the person that we love so much. And we're going to reclaim that, and we're going to keep marching. We are marching 94 years later, and we will continue to march until there are no more ceilings to break. Because we are not a people who live in cages that have ceilings or walls or barriers. We are a people, a free people. People who are free under our law, equal. And so we continue to march, and I hope I see you here next year, not to continue to march for this equality, but to celebrate the fact that we have it. Thank you for being sisters. Thank you for being people who journey together with one another to give us the power to keep on fighting, to continue to speak our truth to power, to be who we were created to be, a person. No matter how small, we are people, and we will continue to march. Thank you.
Thank you, Leah. I also want to point out, you might have known from the sash, that Leah is one of our Women March in Seneca Falls 2018 March and Rally organizers. Remind you of the vendor table. If you're on the other side of this building, please go pay all those wonderful people a visit. And I would just like to say again, thank you. From the bottom of our